Yeah, no, you don't like speed lights and all this other stuff. You keep hearing all these things about them. Well, I like them a lot, so let me give you my side of the story and let's clear up a few misconceptions. So just stick around. Let's talk about this. What's going on, everyone? Seth Miranda here, coming from my studio right here in Manhattan. I'm a pro photographer right here in New York. If you want to check out any of my work, go to Last X Witness on Instagram or all the other social stuff. You may have seen me on some other channels, but this is my own, and I do a lot of stuff about lighting and shooting and photo nerd stuff, so consider hitting subscribe. Speed lights. For me, whenever I do classes or I talk about speed light setups, I get comments, DMs, hands raised in audiences and all sorts of stuff of why they don't like speed lights, why they can't get them to look the way they want them to look, the things that people keep telling them they're a waste of this, blah, 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 that. Well, for me, they're one of the most versatile things out there as far as lighting goes, and I carry anywhere from 4 to 7 of them at a time, depending on what I'm doing or where I'm going. So this is 5 misconceptions that I'm hearing over and over again that I wanna clear up. This is in no particular order. This isn't like number one is the craziest one, so stick with me through all of it, all right? I appreciate that. Number 5. They just look terrible. And what I hear about that is they just have a really hard light. They don't look the way they want them to look. They think no matter how much they spend on a speed light, whether it's something for like under $100 or something that's over $1,000, it doesn't matter, a speed light still doesn't look right to them. Well, that's like any light. If you don't modify it or do what you want to do with that light, you're just getting the raw light. What you want out of the light is raw power so you can have as much light as you can work with once it's expelled from the head. That means you can put it into bigger modifiers, thicker diffusion, make it feel bigger, bounce it off of things, let it react with your subject in certain ways. The lens has a big deal to do with that as far as it being even and hitting a certain way, and even TTL being correct for the exposure you're looking at. But what I think people get wrong is TTL doesn't mean it's perfect out of the gate. It just means the exposure is on point. It might not look good to you. The style of the light might not look good to you. The pattern of the shadows might not look good to you. But the exposure is probably correct with details in the shadows, details in the highlights, all your midtones. You just need to find a way to make it look how you want it to look, which is where all the modifiers and even taking it off camera comes into play. I mean, you can bounce this off the ceiling, bounce it off a wall while it's on camera and change the way it looks, because wherever this light leaves from before it hits your subject basically becomes your light source. If I bounce this off the ceiling, it hits the ceiling, the size of that ceiling reflecting back down makes the light bigger, therefore my shadow pattern is softer, thus softer light. If it's too specular, meaning that there's too much white highlights on someone's skin, oil, reflections, things like that, it's not diffused enough, hence putting it through a diffuser. And you've seen me do this in plenty of videos where I use a 3-foot diffuser from like a reflector or the Manfrotto Halo series that I'm in love with so much. I just blast it through that and this light becomes a 2-stop diffused 3-foot light source, and that's like having an Octa or a shoot-through umbrella that spills everywhere, but it at least lets me get the light quality that I want on my subject just by modifying this. That's kind of the thing I don't think people understand, is that on-camera flash is a style. It's actually pretty well received out there in the fashion world. I mean, major brands have been doing this forever to give it that paparazzi event feel that you're there with them. It's got that amateur type look, but it's actually really clean and nicely done. You just think it's a hard light source blitzing at someone, but what does that do? Gives all the jewelry a hard kick, gives all the textures a really defined look, which is great for fashion to show the yarn and what's sewn on a garment and how it's made and the little details that you might miss should the light be too soft. But what it also really gives is a psychological thing where if a light is on your camera and you're at an event, that's probably how you're shooting, or and that's usually how you would receive how an event was covered. Therefore, it feels like a more organic or natural or believable shot. I'm going a little crazy on this, but it's true. Just because you don't like the way the speed light looks from an on-camera perspective or without a modifier on it at all, doesn't mean it's incorrect or it looks bad. It just means it's not the style you're looking for. Therefore, you need to modify it how you want to, and that's where all the rest of this comes into play. Should I use an umbrella, a softbox? What am I gonna grip it with? What size boxes? Do I use a shoot-through umbrella or a reflected umbrella? Do I use, you know, silver umbrella, white umbrella? All this stuff, it exists because we can really tailor our light to what we're trying to achieve. There's no right or wrong answer creatively, but if you're trying for an effect or a look and it's not coming through, that's where the failure comes into place. I want it to look softer, but for some reason it's not. That's where you're failing. Not that the light is failing, it's doing its job, giving you the raw power, the correct color, the correct exposure, depending on what you're using. And it's up to you to get it to work how you want it to work. I know you hate hearing that, but it is what it is. I mean, you've even seen me use this little flash right here in a video on Adorama TV, bouncing off of this ceiling and making it look pretty clean, if you ask me. You can let me know down below. I'm sure someone's gonna disagree with me. You guys always do in the comments, but just bouncing a light alone can change everything. And maybe there's just techniques with your speed light that you're not in tune with, meaning you probably know to bounce it or do something else with it, but you're just not sure the use case or the application. And that's really what you have to kind of look at and work on. And there's plenty of stuff on my channel here if you want to take a look around of lighting scenarios and things you can do look wise with speed lights. In fact, I think the majority of my demos happen to be with speed lights because I always have them on me. They're small, and I figure that almost everybody has a speed light because a speed light is kind of your first introduction to strobe and creating your own light. So that's usually why I use them so much. Okay, I've been harping on that one for too long. Let's go to number four, which is they are underpowered. No, they're not. They're only underpowered in situations where you need more power. Case in point, you can get from point A to B with a motorcycle, but if you're trying to haul something with it, a lot of weight, it's not gonna get you there. Is that the right use case for it? No. If I was in blazing, crazy, hard sunlight and I'm trying to use this as a key light, meaning I'm trying to overpower the sun, yeah, you're kind of not using it correctly. You're fighting the situation rather than using the sunlight how you'd want to and then using your speed light to clean up or open up the shadows to make them how you want them to look or just refine the shot or the lighting overall. It's not meant to be a replacement for studio. It's meant to be a smaller versatile light that you can use on the fly pretty much. If you need to always max this out, then you might be doing something either wrong setting wise or it might not be the right application for it. Case in point. Let's say I'm shooting a large surface area. Let's say there's like 25 people cramming together in a shot. That means this light has to go further and further away. The farther away it goes, the more power I need to be at exposure for my subject. So let's say, you know, they're 10 feet from this light and I'm getting F8. Well, if I want to keep F8, but get more spread on the light and while I'm moving it back, that means this power has to keep going up. If it's already at 10, by the time I'm halfway covering my surface area, like the 25 people, if I'm only covering like 11 of them, yeah, you're out of power. And that's why higher power units exist. And we're in an amazing time where you have battery powered lights that can do amazing things, fit into small bags and stuff like that. I mean, it's amazing what we have right now, but as far as your speed light being underpowered, it's a use case thing and you can get around it. You can, I guess what I'm trying to say is, if you think that this will always be your key light, you're probably at a misconception right there. Most of the time that you're in very bright ambient situations, you are not going to create your own light as a key. You're going to work with the light that exists. And I've had to fight that plenty of times. You've seen it in videos I've done. But if you're in a closed environment, it's very controlled. You can use a speed light all day and not even go close to full power, depending on what you're doing with it. And you'll be surprised at what you can do with just having a speed light on you. But I am not saying it's a replacement for studio strobes. There's workflow efficiencies and all sorts of things. I could go on forever about that, but speed lights for the most part are not underpowered. It's a use case scenario, just like any other type of gear. Number three, they cost too much. So I actually get this quite a bit. This is a Profoto A10. It is an $1,100 at full price at the time of recording of this video speed light. Whoa, crazy, right? But then there's also some other brands like Flashpoint that have speed lights that start around 60 bucks. They're really not that expensive. You just have to gauge what you really want out of that light and if you're gonna use it so much that you want to invest into it. If it's just a light that you're gonna keep in your bag as a fail safe so that if you're in an environment that you need to create some sort of light, like you're a press photographer, you're an event photographer, and you need to walk around somewhere and have a light just in case you go into a dark spot, but there's something happening you have to cover, maybe you don't need to go crazy for your speed light. But if you're someone like me that has, you know, commercial use cases where I need legit color accuracy, I can't have this thing fluctuate on me with exposure and stuff like that, then yeah, I'm going to go into something that will get the stress of the gear off my back. And that's why I personally chose the Profoto system. And in fact, it's kind of crazy because I was shooting Nikon Speedlights forever. I was collecting them, the SB910s, like crazy. And then I tried this and it changed everything for me, from the way the light looks from the lens, to the color accuracy, to the recycling, to the size that I don't have to carry tons of batteries, which I'm gonna get into in a minute. It changed everything for me. But if you're not someone that's super speedlight heavy, why would you go crazy investing into something you're not using a lot? You could probably get away with something smaller like this just for what you're trying to do. If you just need something that's a quick fill light, if you're just learning flash now, you are absolutely bananas, if not batso, to spend top dollar for pro level speed lights when you could be learning on something that won't break the bank on you and you're not even sure what your style is yet or what you're looking for out of your equipment yet. You're kind of crazy. So there are reasons things cost a different amount, and I'm not gonna go down that rabbit hole. If you guys want me to go into a video on that, hit me with a comment down below, but I'm pretty sure I covered it in my Watt Seconds Explained video. I will put a link in the description for that one. You guys can check that out. It explains everything from speed light to full on studio strobes as far as power goes and what to look for and stuff like that. But that's pretty much the speech on speed lights cost too much. People also say to me that they're so close in price to something like a studio light that we have now that could be battery powered, pretty small. So case in point, if I keep saying that, is that my new phrase, case in point? If this is $1,100 top dollar, this is about $1,600 to $1,800 top dollar, I believe. This is a Profoto B10. They have the B10X out right now at the time of this video recording. Relatively similar in size, right? But they're kind of not. This is exceptionally lighter. This is exceptionally more versatile as far as bendability. Actually, you know what? Let's just get into it. What are we at? Number two, I think. People are saying speed lights are basically over with because stuff like this exists. And this is in all systems, right? Flashpoint, Godox, a lot of other lighting out there. They have systems that if a speed light, which is around 60 to 70 watt seconds, they have 200 to 250, maybe even 300 watt second options out there that are similar in size. But are probably separated in price by a couple hundred, if not a few hundred dollars. That being said, this being $1,100 and this being about $1,600, you're looking at about a $500 price difference, but do you gain a lot more for it? Well, for me, in my opinion, this is another thing where you're picking the right tool for what you're trying to do. So I love the B10. I love the efficiency of this light, how small it is. It's probably the first thing I grab when I'm in my home studio. But when I'm traveling around, I can carry more of these, and the versatility of these adds so much more to what I'm able to do on the out there in the field, which I don't know what I'm going to encounter when I'm doing so many big lighting setups on the fly with short time availability for what we're trying to do. I can lay this on the floor and I can point it wherever I want, and it doesn't need to be gripped up constantly. I can easily put this on my camera as a quick fill light. This is not going on my camera so easily. They are definitely different in weight. This is so easy to grip up. I duct tape these to walls sometimes, it doesn't even matter. But the reality is I'm just able to do a lot of things with this. It'll just fall short when I need that extra power, which is where something like this comes into play. But something like Profoto system, the lights all match and work together seamlessly. And in some cases, in lower cost gear, you'll have your speed light shoot a little colder, looks kind of bluer almost, than your studio strobes. And if this is your key light, and this is your fill light filling in the shadow, your shadow start looking blue for some reason, you wonder why. And that's when you have to start balancing with gels and stuff. And all these people are like, you're gonna fix it in post. You really wanna play games where you have to mask out specific areas of your image to then get the white balance where you want, instead of being a global adjustment when you need to do that kind of stuff. Well, I'm not gonna jump down that, but as far as people saying speed lights are over because we have options like this, these are still bigger, these are still heavier, these are still non-flexible, these are still not able to go on camera, and so much more that I just don't think we're at a place right now, at least, where the speed light is just like, why does this exist? We don't need this anymore. And in my opinion, I think we're always going to need or want or have a use case for at least some sort of on-camera light, especially like I've been talking about with events press and stuff like that, because no matter where I am, if I'm rushing around, I can easily always have a light source with me to keep my images looking cleaner and cleaner and sharper, less noise, all sorts of freeze action, all sorts of stuff like that. If I only have these, I better have an assistant with me dragging this around on a stand or something. It can't stick with me every second that I'm moving fast. And that's where something like this really comes into play. So there's use cases for both, absolutely. And believe me, I am in the camp of, I have no idea what to grab sometimes. I have so many options, but I easily lean on things that I know give me more versatility, because in our game, things are so unpredictable. We don't know what's gonna come our way, but we just wanna have a skill set that can handle anything that comes our way. And we want gear that we don't have to worry about or have to, you know, hack in order for it to work the way we want it to work. So that's my TED talk on that one. But I guess a quick jump back to the original one of they look terrible. Years ago, you didn't have modifiers for these, right? I knew I should have written some sort of script, but that's not my style. We just go on the cuff here. Years ago, your speed light was your speed light and you couldn't find a modifier for it. You had to make something. You've seen me and Daniel have homemade things that we put together, DIY solutions for speed lights years ago. Now, you literally can buy modifiers that are just for speed lights. You can get OCF adapters for this. You can get off-camera adapters, meaning you can put a softbox that's meant for a studio light onto a speed light type adapter of some kind for almost every system that exists out there. And that wasn't the case years ago, but it is now. So you can actually get these to mimic this, and you know, that's kind of what you end up doing with speed lights, is trying to get them to kind of look like bigger lights in most cases, unless you want that paparazzi look. I feel like I just jumped back. I'm sorry I'm confusing you. Yell at me in the comments. You're gonna do it anyway. It is what it is, guys. All right, but the last one I'm gonna talk about is one. I have to do the list thing. I'm not used to this. One is the batteries end up costing more over time than if you would just get something that was a studio strobe. Well, now that's not the case anymore. In fact, that's kind of where everything is going. And this was a big, big issue years ago. I know it's kind of waning now and this shouldn't be like number one on the list, but again, this isn't in order. Years ago, when I used those Nikon flashes or even Canon flashes, you had four batteries in the chamber, right? You had these AA batteries in the chamber, four, and then you had eight more in a battery pack off camera, so you could have faster cycling time and longer shoot time. So you were carrying a ton of stuff here, and every shoot was 12 batteries a light. Yeah. That was a lot of money in batteries, a lot of weight in your bag, and you could even invest into AA rechargeables, which is great, but it's an investment. You want to get good ones. You're talking about a whole nother set of investment of gear for the rechargeable batteries. Nowadays, even some of the most low-cost strobes out there offer some sort of dedicated lithium site battery. I think Flashpoint starts at around $250 for an maybe around three option for something with a lithium ion battery. And that's not just saving you money on having to buy batteries every time for your strobe. It's also a performance thing. You get faster a cycle, you're able to carry less. I can carry four of these batteries in the space of three times what I would carry AA's in just to get through the day, you know? Plus it kind of felt garbagey throwing them in the garbage. Felt garbagey throwing them in the garbage. Ah, English. Anyway, there are so many options, and lithium ion becomes more and more popular, if not standard out there. And if you wanted to go low cost in your lighting, that's where you start seeing a trade-off the most, in my opinion. Aside from the quality of the light coming out of the strobe, you are gonna be spending more money on just AA batteries in some way or form, which kind of negates the fact of saving the money on the speed light. So that's kind of something to consider if you use it that much. And I think you shouldn't even question it, because you don't wanna go out, always have that light in your bag, and the one time you need it, the batteries are dead because you left them in there and that's just what they do. Or they leaked, oh, forget about it. They leaked, the worst. The dedicated battery thing has changed a lot for me. About the only downside I can tell you about having a dedicated rechargeable battery is there has been a very few rare cases I'm out there in the wild and everything's dead and I don't have plugs to plug anything in, and I can't just jam a battery in here. Well, something like this, if I had a store nearby or something, or I just kept a pack of batteries around, I'm back up and running at least to get through some shots. So there, that's something to consider, but you can always carry power banks or all sorts of, I mean, we have so many options for power, it's not even a thing for me anymore. But I will say an advantage to having a studio strobe, something like this, is I don't have to worry about the battery at all. This is always on a battery. I can't plug this into a wall. This I can plug into a wall, keep the battery charged, and let's say I'm in here shooting for a model. I can shoot with her all day plugged in, and she goes, hey, let's go outside for a few shots. I want to try a different look. I unplug and I have a full, fresh battery. I'm in the street, I'm shooting, no problem. This, I hope I have enough batteries left. You know what I'm saying? Or that they're charged up in time to go back out and work off the battery. So that's something else to consider. Anyway, I hope this fixed some misconceptions out there. Basically, they're not underpowered. They don't look like garbage. They don't cost more than you think they have to cost. You can modify them. There's such an open-endedness to this, and they're definitely not done with. There's definitely not a reason out there to just get rid of speed lights in this industry altogether. That is the biggest misconception to me, is that, oh, well, this thing's the size of it, similar price. Why can't I just get that? Because it's limited. And just like this has limitations, it also has versatility. Just like stuff like this has so much more doors open with the power ability and stuff like that. We can't do a lot of things that this can do. So, and the biggest thing for me, I keep on going backwards, the biggest thing to me is I can carry five of these in the same space. I can carry about two or three, about three of these. Think about that as well. So I like to have many lights out there, and I like to zone light things. You know, my model here, that back wall gets this gel. I'm lighting underneath this table. I'm putting this light inside the oven with a red gel. I can do so much stuff just putting lights all over the place in my scene. I'd rather have more of them than just two that I'm working with, and I'm kind of stuck to just like that, even though you can totally do a lot with just one light. So develop your style, look at your tools, see what you're trying to do, and see if you're achieving what you're trying to do. It's just, we have all these options. Don't stray away from learning about what these tools are actually about before you make judgments about them. And don't get caught up in your budget. Think about how far can you stretch the gear that you can afford before you start thinking about, I need to buy something in order to do this. Because you'd be surprised what this can do when you can't afford something like this. Okay, that's gonna do it for me. This one probably went way too long. I keep on rambling. I'm from Brooklyn, we talk, all right, guys? If you're new here, consider hitting subscribe and the bell to get notified more videos like this come out. Hit me down in the comments if there's any other issues you're having with speed lights. I'll try to address them in a future video. Hit like, really helps out the channel. Don't forget to join my Discord. If you're on Discord and you're not in mine, you are missing out on a really nice, positive photo nerd community. A lot of troubleshooting going on there. There's chat rooms for every brand, camera, and lighting in my Discord, so consider joining me there. Follow me at Last X Witness on all social. Check out my work on Instagram, yell at me on Twitter, join me live on Twitch. And I will see you guys next time. Later. That went way too long, I feel.